Well, welcome to the Stoned Roadie Podcast. It's the one you don't want to miss. It stars Craig Reed, the Stoned Roadie, and Griff the Rocket Scientist. Let's not forget Kathy Godsey and all the old friends that come along. Lord, we'll be talking Skinner and leaving you with a song.
I've been selling my soul, working all day, overtime hours for bullshit pay, so I can get out here, waste my life away, drag back home and drown my troubles away. It's a damn shame what this world's gotten to. For people like me, people like you, wish I could just wake up and it not be true, but it is. Oh, it is living in.
Looky here, Griff Martin on the road, and I'm in, I believe, Hopewell, City Point, Virginia, at the Omega Bar. And I was invited by Joey Davis, and he is Oliver Anthony's guitar player, you know, the famous song, Richmond, North of Richmond. So I'm here to do an interview with Joey Davis. And we're gonna find out a little history about Joey and how he got into playing guitar, and also how he got to get hooked up with Oliver Anthony. And so, hope you guys enjoy it. It's gonna be a great time. Okay, inside the Omega Bar here, and this is what it looks like. It's a kind of a quaint little bar in a quaint little town. Nice clean little bar in here. I'm not sure where they set up to play. Probably in here. And so I'm just waiting on Joey Davis to come. And we're going to sit down and have a little chat with him. So here we are at the Omega Bar. Of course, I just walked in and look what's playing. Never fails. Every time I walk into a place, always a Skinner song. Nice quaint little bar here. All right, I just met with Joey here, and he brought all of his gear in, and he's setting it all up, and I'm trying not to bother him while he's getting geared up. He says he travels light. And, I looked at his pedal board over there. He's got some pretty cool pedals. And it's going to be an awesome night of entertainment with Joey Davis on guitar, Keith Horn on bass. Keith Horn, he's a guy, he's played with Peter Frampton, Waylon Jennings, Tanya Tucker, just to mention a few. So we're going to sit down and have a little chat with him here in a little bit, and we're going to listen to some Joey Davis music. Okay, here we are with Joey Davis. We're at the Omega Bar and Grill, and Joey Davis so graciously invited me up here. And we're in, where are we, Joey?
Hopewell, Virginia.
Hopewell, Virginia. Now, those of you that aren't familiar with Joey, certainly you will be soon. He plays with Oliver Anthony. He's his guitarist. And, of course, we all know who Oliver Anthony is. And what we want to do is we want to get a little history here on Joey, find out a little bit about where he was brought up, how he got into music and stuff, and how he hooked up with Oliver Anthony, which is actually Christopher Lunsford, right?
Yeah, that's right.
So let's go back a little bit, and I know he's kind of short on time because he's got a gig here, and he invited me up, and I'm going to film some of it. But appreciate you coming, Joey, here and inviting me down and getting to be a part of this. Let's go back to where were you raised?
Not too far, maybe 30 minutes from here, in
yeah,
a place called Matoka, Virginia.
Matoka?
Yeah.
And we talked a little bit briefly about when you got started. You said you were like 10 years old when you first picked up a guitar.
Yeah, I was started around 10 and went to lessons for 3 or 4 years, and nothing really clicked for me for a while. And then around middle school, I started to really get into it. And then high school, there was a lot of kids better than me, and I didn't like that. So I just kept working at it and working at it, and it's kind of just been my thing ever since, you know.
What do you think spurred it off, your love for music? You have a musical family or anything like that?
I do have a musical family. My grandpa and my uncles, they all play music.
Were they guitar players, string players?
Guitar player and singers, yeah.
Yeah, and they're from this area as well?
Yeah, right? We all kind of, the family's been in this area a while.
And what kind of music was it that you guys were listening to back then?
Back then it was all country, bluegrass, classic country type stuff, and I kind of branched off after that on my own. You know, I had like a rock phase and whatever. Right. I like everything now. I play whatever I can get paid to play.
Yeah, and so you're 29 years old now. We talked about that. So when you were growing up, say 10 years old, when was it that you like probably first played with a couple guys, guitar and stuff like that?
Like,
did you have a band? Start a band?
My uncle had a band, and I started gigging around 14. Is when I really started to play with the group and try to go to all the gigs, you know.
Okay, so 14, were you playing in front of people and things?
Bars, gigs just like this
size. Oh, really?
I mean, yeah.
So you were pretty comfortable with your playing then at 14 years old.
I was okay. Just graciously, my parents or my uncle and his friends let me in the band.
Was it more like just striking some chords and things?
Yeah,
it wasn't much
rhythm
mix.
Guitar that they kept turned down pretty low.
Yeah, so if you guys haven't seen Joey, man, he really ripped some licks off on that, on the electric and the acoustic. So what was your first guitar? What was it? What kind of guitar was it?
A Fender Strat.
Fender Strat.
Yeah. Oh,
so you went right to the electric.
Yeah, I had a Mexican Strat. Someone bought me when I was playing loners for my first year or so, and then probably for Christmas, like around 10 or 11, someone bought me the Strat.
What did you have, like an acoustic in the bedroom whenever you didn't want to make a bunch of noise?
Yeah, my grandpa had a Washburn I would play.
Oh, Washburn, yeah.
And then after that, I played the Strat for a long time, just a little amp or whatever.
And so, like, what was somebody? Let's talk about who was somebody that you looked up to as a musician.
I really like the guy from the Chili Peppers, John Frusciante.
Oh wow!
I love Eric Gales. He's a blues guy.
Yeah,
he's really good.
Oh yeah, I know some people that know him. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm waiting for him to reach out on Instagram or something.
Yeah, from Muscle Shoals area over there.
Yeah, that guy. I saw him actually right over there at the Beacon not too long ago.
Oh, he's yeah? Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, okay, so you were like 14 years old and you were going around gigging. And when was it that you got your first band or you called yourself something?
So late in, I was playing with the band Copperhead. My uncle was the front man. And late into that, 15, maybe 15, I might have been 16. I know I didn't have my license yet. My uncle kind of got some issues with his girlfriend and decided he couldn't be in the band anymore.
Oh yeah.
And so we were gonna hang it up, and I'm like, you know, maybe I could sing too. We'll just see. And so we just started gigging, singing, and I still play some gigs, two or three gigs a year with Copperhead.
Oh,
with
cool.
The same guys, yeah.
So anything like that you did, anything that's memorable to you, some gig that you played that was like really cool, or maybe there was somebody there that you were impressed with, like. It could be even somebody famous. Anything like that ever happen?
I did. I was in a band kind of like the Chili Peppers called Strongbow for a while with my cousin. And we got, I wouldn't say big, but we opened for Seether. We opened for Panic at the Disco. We had a couple decent gigs. So that was cool to do.
So a period of time from, say, 14 until now, it's, for me, it's a short amount of time because I'm an old guy, but for you, I mean, I'm sure it went by slow. And now let's go to where we are now. And you hooked up with Chris, and let's talk about how you met Chris. How did you meet Chris?
I went over right down the street from here to an open mic and played, and I saw Chris play, and he kind of just came up and introduced himself after, and he was saying he wanted to do some gigs. I'm like, well, dude, you sing, just book them. Like,
okay.
Don't worry about the rest of it. And then before he had any really booked anything for us, everything online blew up.
So you didn't even know of him or anything?
No, I had never heard of him until that open mic. And then our first gig was Morris Farm, and there was like 12,000 people there or something. The number changes. It's something like 9 to 12,000 people.
Were there, in this town, were there like a lot of people that were familiar with him, his music and his writings and things?
I don't think so.
No?
He wasn't gigging like... He wasn't playing around bars and stuff, so there wasn't a lot of people that knew. I think the internet kind of got him going.
Would you say that after the open mic, things kind of blew up, or did they blow up before then, or was it after that?
It was after the open mic, because we had sat in my little music room on beanbag chairs, kind of working out covers and stuff, because we thought we were going to be doing, you know, long bar gigs, and then... Next thing I know, we've got all these big gigs booked, so we didn't really need those covers.
So after you guys hooked up, then you where did you like going over to his place and you guys were sitting down and playing, jamming with him and stuff like that?
Yeah, we did two rehearsals at my house where we just basically just sit and worked on covers. And then he had the Morris Farm gig come up, and I agreed to go do it. And I just listened to his music over and over on the way up there. I hadn't even heard some of it. I've never even heard him play. And so Morris Farm was like, all we did was run over it right before we went on stage. That was my first time playing a lot of that stuff.
So you really didn't even get to hear too much of his music when you met him. You were just like, wow. I mean, I'm sure that when you heard some of his songs, you were thinking, wow, these are some pretty cool songs, right?
Yeah, I thought it was good. And I was like, man, he can really sing. He's like... And he was saying, you know, he hadn't really bought any kind of sound equipment or anything, but he was thinking about gigging, and he had, like, some traction starting to go on the internet. And I'm like, you know, I got speakers. Let's just book the gigs and figure out what happens after that. And he sure did a good job booking them, I'll say.
And when you were at the open mic, what was the audience reaction at that time? Was it a lot of people there?
That place is usually pretty much full whenever you do open mics there.
When he sang the song Richmond, North of Richmond, was that like an explosion when people heard that, just like it is now?
That song wasn't even written.
It wasn't?
When we did that open mic.
Oh, wow. Really? So he just wrote that song, and you were with him basically as his guitar player when he wrote it.
Yeah, but I had nothing to do with him writing that song.
Right.
That was all credit to him. I was sitting at home probably getting high when he wrote that song.
When you got with him and you first heard him sing the lyrics to it, what did you think about that?
I thought it was a good song. I mean, a kick-ass song. It just took kind of the world by storm. I mean, it was viral before I even heard it.
What do you think came about in his mind as far as being able to come up with those lyrics, hanging around him? Is he like, is he pretty much, I know he's not really politically to one political view, but does he ever talk to you about any of that?
No, I wouldn't want to speak for him for sure on anything right. like that, but that's not any topic of our conversation. Like,
yeah.
To me, I can speak for me, and I think it's all basically made up. So it doesn't, like, I have no big, strong opinion on any of it. But, yeah, I definitely wouldn't want to speak for him. We don't. Okay. It's not something we talk about at all.
Well, let's move in a different direction and talk a little bit more about your abilities as a guitar player with him. It had to be pretty difficult. I mean, well, of course, you're a very accomplished guitar player, but in such a short time to come up with these riffs and these things, and then memorize them and then go on the road. Was it pretty hard to come up with these? Did you help him with a lot of the actual music as far as writing the chords and things like that?
Or no, did he do all of the writing, 100% of it is him. All I did was show up to the gig and put some
licks in there.
Licks and solos in there, yeah. And for the first couple gigs, honestly, I was following him because I barely knew the songs. I had just listened to him a bunch on Spotify. And we are doing them, a few of them in different keys than what they were on Spotify. Yeah. And I'm like, you know, I just kind of was along for the ride. I had nothing to do with the chords or any of that.
But one thing I've noticed, you know, is that when you play, there's a lot to it. And so memorizing all that, do you find it difficult or is it just come to you pretty fast?
I lived in Nashville a little bit over a year. And a lot of my money I made by picking up last minute gigs and learning their 50 or 60 song set list and, you know what I mean? So it's easy for me to learn stuff and keep it in my brain, right. Musically at least.
Okay, well, I know you're wanting to go in there and get set up for your gig, so I'm just going to ask you a couple more things here. As far as where you're going, where do you think things are going to go? What are you guys looking at as far as the future together?
I mean, I think we're going to at least do a handful more gigs with the two of us and then maybe add a couple guys. We're not set in stone on what we're going to do with that. But we're looking at touring next year. Not too busy, but busy enough to keep everything going.
Okay. And so whenever you guys travel, is it kind of like a mob now? I know you said you were shaking a bunch of hands and you actually came down with a cold actually.
Yeah, that was after we did a gig and there was like, I don't know, 9,000 or 10,000 people there, and it felt like every one of them lined up to meet us afterwards, and we met everybody till the line was empty.
And it's slowly growing, well, fast, growing kind of fast actually.
Yeah, that's for sure.
Okay, well, one more question. Tonight, what are we going to be listening to as far as what you're playing?
Oh, well, it's no telling. I'll take a lot of requests. Me and these guys, we have like a 1,500-song repertoire, so we'll do a little bit of everything. You'll hear some Michael Jackson, some Toto, I don't know, some Prince, Zac Brown. It could be anything.
Oh, cool. Is it going to bother you if I kind of get up close and personal with the camera?
Whatever you want to do, man.
Cool. All right, Joey Davis, man, what a great guy, you know, invited me up here, and we got a little interview with him. He's going to let us put it on the Stoned Roadie podcast, and say hi to all the Stoned Roadie fans.
Hey, y'all.
Thank you, Joey Davis, appreciate it, man.
Thank you.
All right.
Okay, here we have Helen Hunter, not Helen Hunt, the movie star, but just as beautiful, right? I was talking to her and her husband in there earlier, and she's a big fan, a big, big, huge, huge fan of Joey Davis, right? So what is it that you like about Joey so much?
He's amazing. Joey's the best. Joey plays whatever the audience wants to hear, and he sounds amazing.
How long have you known him?
2 years.
2 years?
Yes.
And where did you first see him at?
Here.
Here?
The sheriff for Hopewell. We came for his party, he won, and Joey was playing. And since then, we've gone to see him everywhere. We love him.
Have you seen Oliver Anthony anywhere here around here?
No.
No?
Just Joey.
What did you think about when you found out that he was playing with that guy and he's so
cool? I loved it, but I felt sad because I was like, oh, look, it's Joey. I'm not sad.
Oh, yeah, but didn't he play at your daughter's, what was it?
Yeah,
that
baby shower.
Baby shower.
Yes, we did. We had him play in our backyard for her baby shower. We were up till 5 a.m. He is amazing.
How long ago was that?
She just turned 12 months, 13 months. So gave me money for another show.
He's going to be kind of like the Keith Richards of the Oliver Anthony Band, right?
I hope so.
Well, and so now you can say, yeah, Keith Richards, yep. Joey Davis,
yes, Joey
played at the baby shower, right?
Absolutely, and then, his wife. So yeah. She sits with us, and we sit with her. She's wonderful.
Oh, cool.
We love him. You haven't heard his best song yet.
Yeah, what is that song
now? White House Road by Tyler Childers.
White House Road.
Yes, okay. So don't leave till you hear that.
Well, Helen Hunter, we really appreciate you coming on the Stoned Roadie podcast and talking about
Roadie Day.
This is,
you're
such a sweet lady.
He's the best.
And your husband is a great guy. And
I'm glad you're here. You're going to love him. Don't leave till you hear my song.
Thank you so much.
No, thank you.
All right.
Thank you. You're
going
to love him.
Bye-bye.
Early in the morning when the sun does rise. Laying in the bay with bloodshot eyes.
my bed. In 99 and 1 half days. Hold up, something's wrong, yeah. My key won't unlock this old door. I said, hold up, wait a minute, something's wrong with you, baby. My key won't unlock this old door. Yeah, I got a bad idea. My baby don't live here anymore. But I got my guitar. Come on now.
Okay, I've got a couple interesting guys right here, and myself, you know, I've never interviewed anybody that's been on American Idol. That's kind of cool. I used to watch American Idol back in the day, but I haven't seen it in a while. Now, tell me your name.
My name's Kenny Miles. I'm from Colonial Heights, Virginia.
Okay, and your name?
My name's Nuke Bushner.
Nuke
Parsons, Kansas.
Bushner. From Kansas? Where at,
sir?
Kansas?
Parsons, Kansas.
Parsons, Kansas. It might get loud here in a minute. So, what are you doing here, Nuke Bushner?
Actually, I'm in Virginia right now doing a few shows with my man here.
Yeah?
And we figured we'd stop in because we heard a couple guys were playing tonight.
Right.
We wanted to hear some live music, so we stepped in, and as soon as we got here, they're like, well, does anybody want to get on stage and play a song? So
yeah,
figured we'd take advantage of that opportunity. Here we are with you now, man.
Now, you're Nuke's manager, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah? So, were you around with him when he did the American Idol thing?
No, I was not. I met Nuke about 3 years ago.
Yeah?
And we probably did 75 shows together over the years.
Cool.
Over a few years.
Your American Idol experience, who were the judges?
The judges were Keith Urban, Jennifer Lopez, and Harry Connick Jr.
Oh, wow. Cool.
Yeah.
How did you do?
I advanced to Hollywood and then later on dropped out, you know, later in the season. But all in all, it was a great opportunity, man, and a fun experience at that. So.
You got a great sound. You really do sound good.
Thank you, man.
So how many weeks were you involved with American Idol?
It was actually about a couple months, really. It's a pretty ongoing deal there.
So what episode would it be if we went to look for it somewhere on, like, say, YouTube or something?
It was season 2015.
All you have to do is just Nuke Bushner, American Idol,
okay,
and it will pop up.
Well, what kind of songs did you sing, like, when you were on American Idol?
So I actually sang one of Keith Urban's songs, Tonight I Wanna Cry.
That was a good choice, being how he's a judge, right?
Yeah.
Did you pick that song out?
I did. People thought I was crazy for doing it, but
is there like anything behind the scenes that was pretty cool that you could tell us about?
Yeah, I mean, there was quite a few things. One of the things was meeting everybody, just all the different contestants and the kids that were there, and seeing how they traveled so far to get there and do what I do. So that was pretty cool, and just meeting the judges, talking to them, you know, behind the scenes is pretty awesome.
Yeah. And so have you been contacted by them at all recently or anything? Got anything, any breaks?
Not recently, no, but a lot of great things came out of it. A lot of great things came out of it. I would say me and Keith Urban were pretty good buddies.
Well, hey, I I appreciate you guys coming on here, and that's really cool to talk to an American Idol guy, you know. It's like really awesome. And you sound great. I got you recorded, and we're going to put you on the podcast.
All right, man. I appreciate it.
Thank you, man.
It's nice to meet you, buddy. You can see through his disguise. Take a step in the wrong direction. He got his hold on me. Met the devil in Oklahoma. Been a tough time getting free. Sent me sitting on a riverbank, praying in Jesus' name, come and save my soul. Out of time, it was never on my side.
Try again. We've
still remember me. I must be traveling on now. There's too many places I've got to see. If I stay here with you, squirrel, things just couldn't be the same. I'm as free as a bird now, and this bird you cannot change. And this bird you cannot change. And this bird you cannot change. Lord knows I can't change. Find my baby, just that sweet love. This feeling I can't change. Please don't take it so badly. Lord knows I'm to blame. If I'd stay here with you, girl, things just couldn't be the same. I'm as free as a bird now, and this bird you cannot change. We'll be right back.
Yeah, the Road Stoney Show.